Greetings, everyone. Welcome to your affirming interfaith Swedenborgian community. A community inspired by a mystical Christianity that believes that there are many ways to the heavenly city, many paths to connecting with heaven and God, different traditions, different ideas, but it all centers on love. All the ways that we can commune in life with each other, with divinity that are truly like heaven, come from compassion, care, wisdom, and love. Today I'm wearing kind of some fancy digs, partly because at my church in Canada, the Church of the Good Shepherd, we are celebrating communion today. And so today we're going to reflect on that, and we're also going to reflect on Thanksgiving, which in Canada we celebrate in October, as I'll chat a little bit more about in a moment, and really reflect on what it means to be called to communion, called to Thanksgiving, and connect with each other, remembering divinity, remembering God, our higher power. But before we get to that, let us open in a meditative mode, just allowing ourselves to feel our breath, center our hearts, opening our scriptures, lighting our candles, all the things that you do to create your worshipful space, if you do anything. Allowing yourself to come to the moment, letting go of the thoughts, the judgments that we often carry. Often we project judgments that are somewhat true about ourselves that we want to hide away from. And often we cast ourselves under judgmental light as well, in a hard, harsh way that I think meditation and other centering exercises help us be aware of and let go of a little bit, moving more into acceptance and connection with how wonderful we are, how much of a blessing everything is, even amidst some of the dysfunction and destruction that we see in society, that we see in the world today. Now, the Passover is a holiday, it's a momentous occasion every year that the Jewish people and others, including some in the Christian faith, celebrate to remind themselves of God's saving of the Israelite people from Egypt, the exodus from Egypt. And if you think about that story and the history of the Israelites and what many people call the Old Testament or the Hebrew Bible, you'll be reminded of the sacrifices that occur throughout the tradition, but especially in that instance and in the Passovers since then, of sacrificing the lamb, the best lamb of the fold, and offering that to God, of helping to relinquish our sins, our destructiveness, offering it as a way to create atonement with divinity. Now, we all have different points of view in it. Even Jews maybe approach some of those ideas differently than each other. But it's interesting because the Christian tradition almost always carries that idea forward, relating it to Christ. And that's something Christ does himself and the Gospels do, saying that, oh, we no longer sacrifice the lamb, Christ has died for us. Now, the Swedenborgian tradition is, as I said, a mystical Christianity, but one that also enfolds people of many different viewpoints, interfaith beliefs. And so none of us will approach it the same way either. But Swedenborg, the theologian from the 18th century who explored a lot of these topics in his writings, who helped inspire our tradition, He believed that, yes, Christ, in a sense, is the image of the Lamb. But it's not that he replaces the Lamb, although that's what happened in practice. It's that actually all these things are images of God from the get-go. That the sacrifices in the Israelite church were images of God then, the Lamb, the best of the fold. Even other sacrificial holidays and occurrences are similar in that sense. In a lot of ways, if you look at death in Scripture, they tie back to transformation, tie back to renewal of life, even though it sometimes seems a little bit morbid that we would sacrifice a lamb, or even sacrifice Christ in a sense. And really, though, the Scriptures point to the life. And often we forget that it's not Christ's death that is the true message of any of the Gospels. It's not really the death that is saving. It's God with us that transforms our lives that is saving. As Christ often uplifted, you must allow yourself to be transformed to really have relationship with me. And it doesn't matter the name we use for God. We may have different ideas about divinity, what Scripture. We may not even believe in quote-unquote divinity or a higher power. We may talk about the universe's providence in our lives. It may just be a more felt sense of connecting with God's qualities, all the infinite goodness that makes up God, the love that's at the core of God and that God conveys to us. We have different ideas. But ultimately, most of us would agree life is about living, and we should uplift each other. And salvation, in a biblical sense, isn't actually about whether or not the thing or God died. Whether it's the lamb, whether it's a more physical practice where you maybe knock down something or something symbolic about destruction and renewal, or if it's the crucifixion itself that's at the heart of much of our thinking around salvation, it's really about the life. It's about the renewal, and that's the importance of Christ's resurrection. The Lamb appears again in Revelation. This whole stained glass window is about Revelation. I'll maybe show it to you for those of you watching and interested. And it's interesting because in Revelation, Christ appears as a lamb as well. And is a ruler, is a lamb that is whole, bleeding as if slain, but living. It's a fascinating picture. They didn't include the blood in this stained glass window. But really, as we'll see as we explore this topic further, it comes down to receiving God's life in every moment and acknowledging the source of all our gifts, all our ability to commune, all our sustenance. Acknowledging that it comes from divinity, comes from the Holy One within and around us, and that we should uplift that Holy One's presence with all people in a way that they can receive in their own diverse viewpoint as much as we can. All right, well, let us hear today's message. Thank you for joining us, and especially thanks to those of you connecting with us live.
Well, despite my robes, you know we like to keep it informal here. And so don't worry about the sounds of the kids. Even if some of the older kids were to stay behind, I think that's a lovely noise to add to our celebration, our Thanksgiving. And it is Thanksgiving season. For those of you with the online community, you might be surprised to hear that today that's one of our key focuses because in Canada, we celebrate it in October, which, as I mentioned before, I greatly appreciate it, especially because it starts to get chilly here in October, and I think that's around the time where the leaves change and you want to kind connect with other people in the warmth of family and friends if we are so lucky, and to connect perhaps with what gives rise to community and love within, even if we may feel isolated and alone sometimes. So we're uplifting this idea of Thanksgiving, but today we're also celebrating communion, which I think fits perfectly with the idea of Thanksgiving. In fact, you may have heard this before, but the Eucharist is another name for communion. And Eucharist, I believe, means to give thanks. And so it's a perfect encapsulation of the holiday, of the spirit, I think, of why, the spirit that gives rise to why we love holidays like this so much, which is giving thanks, which is communing. And that's the other name for this ritual within the Christian church often, communion. And communion, I think, speaks to another aspect of giving thanks, which is we do it in community. We give thanks for all the gifts that we receive in our life, in our context, which most of which are thanks to community. Even the roads that we drove in on, the safety of our communities, the joy that we find every day comes from communion, in a sense. And so we celebrate connection and all the good things that we have to be thankful for. As I mentioned in our children's message a moment ago, I believe, and I'm sure many of you do as well, that God is the true originator of all the gifts of life. All the gifts within our spirit, within even our bodies, and all the gifts in community, even in society, even in the face of some of the more hurtful modes of being, even in the midst of some of the horrors of the world. I really love that you all bring food offerings today for those in need. I think it fits at the heart of where Thanksgiving begins, which is an offering to those who have less to be thankful for. It's hard to truly be thankful in a world where so many people go hungry. And so I believe at least presenting ourselves in a posture that uplifts others, looking at our hearts, looking at our lives, and shaping them slowly, fast as we can, to uplift others should be at the root of our Thanksgiving. And meals, particularly, are often uplifted in moments of Thanksgiving and moments of celebration and communion. I think that's for good reason. As I mentioned, many people sometimes suffer from not getting enough food. And so often if we come together in community, we want to uplift just the basic life, the basic health of those who come together. But even more so, perhaps, food is sustenance for us all, and uplifts this idea that we don't live of ourselves alone. And in fact, it takes community to fill the Thanksgiving table. It takes community to fill our own table, even if we're at home alone. Community to grow, to create, to offer the systems, to build the healthy boundaries, let's say, that allow for a functioning society, that hopefully starts to allow for the feeding of those who are less fortunate, encouraging offerings, encouraging our effort for health and wholeness. Many of you probably know the roots of communion, but I'll touch on it for just a moment. The Last Supper, as we often call it, was a moment in Christ's life, an important time in his ministry the ministry of that of his disciples right before his arrest and execution. But actually, the Last Supper, the name the Last Supper, is kind of a misnomer. Anyone know why it's kind of a misnomer? I'm sure some of you do. If you think about your gospel stories, there's actually later suppers with Christ. There are actually a few other meals with the resurrected Christ in the gospel account. But it was the Last Supper before his arrest. And as we know, he sat down with the disciples and he gave thanks to God and said, consume this bread and this wine in thanksgiving, in remembrance of me, in contemplation of me, not just in a passing memorial sense. No, Christ uplifts this idea that he is present every time we receive nourishment, receive bread and wine in his name, in remembrance of the divinity that he embodied. In a way, I think this transcends Christianity. I think any time we come to a meal, any time, in fact, that we receive sustenance within or without, acknowledging, remembering God, remembering the source of being itself, is a type of communion. And Christ uplifts its importance at the last meal before his death. I can only imagine what that was like for the disciples. Sitting there with Christ, him emphasizing that he's about to die bodily, but also be resurrected. Kind of horrific in a sense. Because there was no impending acts as far as they could tell. They knew that there was trials in society, some challenges to Christ's authority, upset religious leaders at breaking the status quo that Christ did. But it's hard to hear from your leader that they know through their general deep knowledge and omnipotence that they are about to be arrested and executed. And in the midst of that conversation, that idea, they're eating, and Christ stands up to uplift something kind of sad, a memorial for himself, but also the hope that I think we all can find in Christ, which is that he's always with us. Divinity's always present. Hopefully, full of hope for our transformation, for our coming to the communion table of our own accord in remembrance of him. Again, communion table is a symbol. It's not a necessity for salvation or even a necessity to be part of this church. But I think symbols are important. Just like having and cultivating healthy intentions, the qualities of God within, and in our actions, symbols, liturgy, robes that we normally don't wear, can be an important element to uplift the deeper meaning in celebration, thanksgiving, God's wonderful presence and grace with us, even amidst some of our own dysfunction. Offering the gifts that allow for our living, even in the spiritual realm, even amidst our dysfunction. I do think that we are called to receive communion in our lives. It's easy, I know it's easy, to get caught up in selfishness and hurtfulness. Even if we don't call it that to ourselves, if we are to reflect and think about our mode of being, how we think about others, how we judge even ourselves, Often, we're somewhat destructive in it. We carry shame. We carry hurt and hurting. Christ, even amidst that fear, that sorrow of the Last Supper, uplifts, it's still time to give thanks. And receive this even more than you have before in remembrance of me. It's a tough idea. Because I think it's easy to be in our bubble saying, well, things are pretty good for me, so I can give thanks. Even when the world around us is hurting in so many horrible ways, it makes sense. We have a hard time challenging the status quo on our own. Efforts like the food drive and other communal offerings, I think, go a long way, actually, to showing that we can change the way of our society, that we can at least start to change it. But it's easy to be in our silo and to give thanks if things are going well. Now, when things start to go poorly, we tend to turn towards the myth if we pray at all. It's distracting. The blood goes to our legs. We might want to run. We might want to change what's happening, and we forget that God is the transformational powers. So many scriptures, so many religions uplift, and Christianity uplifts so beautifully well. As Christ preached again and again throughout his life, transform, turn, know me, eat, receive in remembrance of me. Do everything, acknowledging the gifts of God, the empowerment that divinity brings. Now, Emanuel Swedenborg, the mystical thinker, I know not everyone likes the idea, the term mystical. I do. I think the young folks like it too, honestly. And we're all young at heart, hopefully. Mystical, to me, uplifts this idea of kind of breaking the boundaries of whatever religious mode they're coming out of. And Swedenborg was a mystical Christian, much like how Rumi was a mystical Muslim. And we all, I hope, have had the occasion to appreciate Rumi's poetry and his focus on love and uplifting other people. Swedenborg was much the same. Focusing on love, focusing on how God can be put in a box and is in fact in everyone's heart and in every created thing, in our environments, in our nature. So much to give thanks for. And Swedenborg uplifts this idea that all of Scripture is a symbol to uplift that love in us, to encourage it. Sometimes it's very straight to the heart of the matter, and sometimes it's more veiled. And Christ uplifting the bread and the wine for Swedenborg also has a very specific, deeper meaning, as he explores in his writings. And he doesn't just come up with that deeper meaning out of the blue. He actually points to many scriptures that uplift bread as the bread of life, as what gives us love, the goodness that brings us to the table, that keeps communities together, that overcomes differences. And he points that out and he says that's what Christ is uplifting when he uplifts that bread. He's uplifting food as well. He's uplifting all the nourishment that entails goodness, all the gifts of divinity that empower us, that give rise to our bodies, our ability to move within and without. And when he uplifts the wine, as Scripture often does, he's uplifting wine as a symbol for God's truth, for God's wisdom in our lives. Now, there are places where wine is uplifted in the opposite way. Strong wine, the drunkenness that occurs if we drink too much, is often uplifted as a symbol for how we can behave when we're not communing, even when we don't know it. When we're not turning towards the godly qualities within as the source of our being, as the core of our motivations. But in a positive light, wine is not that falsity, not that destructiveness, but truth, wisdom of being. The ability to uplift goodness, to uplift more truth in other people, to meet them in openness as the open communion table represents, and looking for ways to empower them, give them energy for their lives. And he relates the same things to Christ's flesh and blood. I don't know if you remember, but in that story, when Christ lifts the bread and the wine, he calls it his flesh and his blood. I mean, it's kind of funny that we're talking about this in October, and we're starting to see all the Halloween decorations. We've decorated our front door with a monster, but not too scary. But hopefully. But it's interesting because Christ uplifting flesh and blood at communion seems a little shocking sometimes. And I know in our history as Christians, as religious people on the earth, sometimes we've taken our literalism too far, or maybe not. But often the focus is that this is Christ's flesh and blood. It might literally turn into that when you eat it. Sometimes that's the idea uplifted in communion and the Eucharist. But if we look at our scripture and sit with them, we start to notice that God talks about flesh and blood. Scripture talks about flesh and blood quite a bit. And it's talking about partaking in what it means to have God in your life, to have thanksgiving in your heart. Taking a moment to appreciate community, to receive the nourishment within that's always there for the taking in God's name, however we may say it. Flesh and blood symbolize life, the goodness and truth of the bread and wine, all the things that make this reality what it is, honestly. And I think that's a powerful message. It's one of the last messages that we hear from Christ before the harrowing journey to the cross. Because even in the midst of our own cross-carrying, our own traumas, and that of the world, we're called to remember and celebrate. We can't survive without God. We have different names for God. We relate to divinity, the qualities that make up the Holy One, all goodness, all truth, all love, in different ways. Some people may call God the universe and not know it. I'm sure you've heard this before. Some folks relate to how the universe is bringing so many gifts to their lives, the providence in the universe, uplifting so much health. They may even turn towards nature, turn towards other words for God as well, turn towards spirit. And I hope that in its most healthy sense, that is a type of worship of God, it's a type of communion. I hope that for myself too, when I use the word God. Christ, Krishna, Sophia. And really, our outreach efforts in every moment of our lives, the posture of our intent, and how it feeds into every moment is a type of communion if we allow it to be so. Accepting that we're not perfect, but that God, Scripture, through the symbols that has so much power uplifts. Yes, greater perfection, as Christ says, be perfect as my Father God is perfect. Greater goodness, what's more perfect than goodness? Greater wisdom, healthy connection and community, thanksgiving, and yes, joy for all that we have to be thankful for. God invites all of us to the table. Our higher power is present in every connection in our lives. Every time you walk by someone, and especially when we sit with family and friends, is an opportunity for communion, for remembering the source of our being, for leaning a little bit more into gratitude and joy, even when things are going wrong. And it points to the hope that we find at our Thanksgiving table. And so let us uplift that hope as we can, as others will receive it, empowered by Christ, the living Lord. Now let's take a moment, closing our eyes as we feel called, opening our hands as we feel called, and taking a few deep breaths. Feeling of sustenance that gives rise to our being within. Allowing the thoughts to fade, the judgments towards others, the judgments towards ourselves to fade as they can. Accepting that we all are. There's room to grow. No need to be defensive. Often our judgments towards others are things we don't like to see in ourselves. The judgmental voice towards ourselves are often places we can grow, but not the end of the world as they sometimes feel. Allow God to nourish the part of you being stifled by that judgment, by the obsessive thinking as it can subside. Feeling a breath, allowing that to help you come into the moment. Allowing the sounds in the room to also help you engage with the presence. Feeling of your body, of your face. Accepting that there may be pain. But there's much to be thankful for. Much gratitude to be leaned into, to be received and offered. Much grace in every moment.
As we contemplate today's message, let us listen to some music reflecting on how divinity is speaking to us today.
Still seek him. Wise women seek him too. they sense a greater power. They're searching for the truth. Some are in the temple or praying in a mosque. Some are in the garden or kneeling at the cross. Still others look for data, for empirical proof of a world beyond our senses, for everlasting youth. Resigned to never knowing, some never will ask why, nor understand the earth, never questioning the sky. It all comes down to asking, then questioning some more. Can we see a bigger picture? Can our faith open the door? Perhaps the wisest ones of all find answers in the home, for the still small voice inside their heart that says, I'm not alone. There is a greater purpose for our struggles as we grow, to choose to live a life of love and serve the best we know. Wise men still seek him, wise women seek him too. They sense a greater power, they're searching for the truth. I'm searching for him too.
That was Paul Dimmick, a wonderful pastor out of St. Louis, Missouri. He has amazing music. I encourage you all, if you like that, to find his music online. And it's nice just to be able to share Swedenborgian's music with each other, and music that may not fall under the Swedenborgian lens, whatever that means, right? That uplifts similar things: love, kindness, openness, and support, our walks with God. Now let us turn to a mode of prayer. As we listen to a song from Lori and Ken Turley.
One, two. When I try to rely on my own resources, if I don't watch every word I say, I'll be making apologies night and day. And so I try to relax, I'll hold my horses and ask for love to follow through. You know I got to give it all up to you. And so I'm giving it up,
giving it up
to you, God. I'm giving it up to you. I'm giving it up to you, God. I'm giving it up to you. It's easy to be hateful in a world of plenty. No matter how many things we get, you know there's always something looking better yet. We gotta learn to be grateful, walk a little more gently, and ask for love to follow through. You know we got to give it all up to you. And so I'm giving it up,
giving it up
to you, God. I'm giving it up to you. I'm giving it up to you, God. I'm giving it up to you. I don't always have the answers, I don't always know the right thing to say. Oh, with one side here and another side, miscommunication's getting in the way. But when I step back from the picture and I ask for help from you, I know that sooner or later, greater and greater, love is gonna speak the truth. I'm giving it up
to you,
to you, God. I'm giving it up to you. I'm giving it up to you, God. I'm giving it up to you. Giving it up to you, God. I'm giving it up to you. Giving it up to you, God. I'm giving it up to you. When I try to rely on my own resources, if I don't watch every word I say, I've been making apologies night and day. And so I try to relax, I hold my horses. And as for love to follow through, you know I got to give it all up to you. So I'm giving it up to you, God. I'm giving it up to you. I'm giving it up,
giving it up
to you, God. I'm giving it up to you. Giving it up to you, God. I'm giving it up to you. I'm giving it up to you, God. I'm giving it up to you. I'm giving it up to you, God. I'm giving it up to you. I'm giving it up to you, God. I'm giving it up to you. I'm giving it up to you, God. I'm giving it up to you. I'm giving it up to you, God. I'm giving it up to you.
God, today, communing with you is all the more important given the destruction in our world, given the horrors, given the trauma, given the pain that many of us carry. Help us to lament. Help us to find gratitude as well, to find thanksgiving, even in the midst of the toil, allowing that to empower us to world transformation and internal transformation. Because as you often said in your earthly life, according to the Gospels, transform, turn around, repent, change is the meaning of what you said. Turn away from your destructive practices, our tendency to use our religion as a bat, as something to oppress people with, as you often critique the Pharisees for in the gospel. Help us not to use our religion or our ideas, our science that way. Help us to instead look at the heart of creation and see from the smallest things to the greatest, the roots of community, of diverse elements coming together to create something bigger. Thank you for the image of your life and everything, the life, the love, the joy that we can lean into in ourselves. Thanks to your empowerment, your willingness to give all of yourself in every moment to each of us, to the extent we're willing to receive it. Help us to receive all our sustenance in remembrance of you, in contemplation and awareness of your presence with and in and through everything. The sustenance of gravity, of Mother Nature. Let us continue to consume, continue to be uplifted and sustained toward health, toward greater justice in our own lives and in our society. No longer crucifying you, crucifying nature through our lack of appreciation, through our idea that you are not present in all things that sustain us. Let us stop the destructive environmental impact. Let us transform our personal practices, our personal intentions, and transform our societies. Lord, we each have many things we brought to you today. We know they're in your hands. Thank you, O Heavenly Lady, O Divine Holy One, for your inspiration, for your wisdom, your presence in the eyes and the beings around us. In your heavenly name we pray, no matter how we might say it. Amen. Well, thank you all for joining us today. It's always nice to connect. Please share your thoughts, your feedback even. It can be negative. That would be great with me. You can reach out on any of the platforms we're on for the most part. Some of the podcasting platforms are hard to comment on, but you can find us on YouTube. You can find us on our website, swedenborgiancommunity.org. We have a Facebook page and also a new group. The group is just getting started, so if you feel like you can bring some conversation and connection to a Facebook group and want to connect with people of like-minded and hearted folks, please find that Facebook group and let us continue to connect and share. Now go forth knowing you're quite loved, receiving the communion of divinity and remembrance of that divinity within, without, and uplifting others to do the same in their own way.